Hello, today I'm going to talk about decision problems and information theory. And this is joint work with Mahmoud Abokamis for Kyung Colitis and Hank Noh. And my name is Tan Suju. This talk is based on a paper that appears in ICAR 2020, and it is a talk presented at the conference. Information inequalities are inequalities between entropic terms, and they have been called by Nick Pippinger in 1986 the laws of information theory. Today, they have even more application than they had back in 1986, and today we require even more complex laws of information than linear information inequalities. Yet, the most basic algorithmic questions remain open. It is open today, even whether deciding simple linear information inequalities is decidable. In this talk, my goal is to introduce several decision problems in information theory, and present some results on their complexity, on their algorithmic complexity by placing them in the arithmetic hierarchy. A quick outline of my talk, I will give some basic definitions, then I will define decision problems in information theory, briefly mention some applications, then describe the results and conclude. In this talk, we will be concerned with finite probability spaces and a random variable over such a probability space. The entropy of this random variable is defined in the standard way. It is a sum over all outcomes of that random variable of the probability of that outcome times log of the probability of that outcome with a minus sign. In this talk, we are interested not in a single random variable, but in n joint random variables x1 up to xn. For any subset of these random variables, we consider the entropy of that subset. So therefore, we have 2 to the power n entropic values or entropic terms. And we denote them like you can see here, h of x1, x4 of h or h of xyz. This means the entropy of the joint distribution of the variables x, y, and z. When x and y are sets of random variables, then we denote their union by simply dropping the union term, right? X, y for the union. And we will often use these standard definitions. The conditional entropy, written h of y bar x, is simply the difference of two entropic terms, the union of all the variables minus the entropy of the variable on which we condition. And the conditional mutual information, I of yz conditioned on x, it's a sum of four entropic terms that are represented here. The details are not very important for this talk. Okay, since there are 2 to the power n possible entropic values, we view them as a vector. And conversely, given a vector boldface h, a vector with 2 to the power n dimensions, we call it entropic if there exists n random variables such that for each component of the vector, its value is precisely the entropy of those subsets of random variables. So for that reason, because we view entropies as a vector, we will often denote them with lowercase. So we would write lowercase h of a subset of random variables. The set of all entropic vectors is denoted with gamma n star. It is a notation introduced by Zhang and Yong in the 90s. It is known that this set is not topologically closed and it is not convex. However, its topological closure, denoted with bar gamma n star, is known to be convex. It is much better behaved. And the vectors inside this set are called almost entropic vectors. They are simple limits of sequences of entropic vectors. It is known that for n greater than or equal to 3, the set of entropic vectors is strictly included in the set of almost entropic vectors. Okay, so with these basic definitions, we can now describe the topic of our talk today, which are information inequalities. These are simple assertions that a linear combination of entropic terms is greater than or equal to 0. C denotes a vector of coefficients. They are real numbers. And C dot H is the standard dot product. We say that inequality is valid for all entropic vectors, or gamma star n valid, if it holds for all entropic vectors. Similarly, we can refer to validity over almost entropic, or a set of almost entropic vectors. And because these inequalities are very simple linear expressions, the notions of validity over entropic vectors coincides with the notion of validity over almost entropic vectors. Good. So this justifies our first problem statement, which is the information inequality problem, which is as follows. Given an information inequality with integer coefficients, decide if it is valid. Check if it is valid. We insist on the coefficients being integers because we want to use this as a decision problem. Okay, so to give you some examples of valid inequalities, here are the very well-known Shannon basic inequalities. They are called monotonicity, which says that the entropy of more random variables is greater than or equal to the entropy of a subset of random variables, and submodularity. These information inequalities are known to be valid. Their consequences are called Shannon inequalities, and it is decidable if a given linear inequality is a Shannon inequality. In other words, it is decidable if a given linear inequality is a consequence of Shannon's basic inequalities. Here is an example. This is an inequality, which is a Shannon inequality. It means it is a consequence of C3, and therefore it is valid. So let's prove that this inequality is a consequence of Shannon's basic inequalities. So we start with a term on the left, and we apply some modularity to the first two terms. This allows us to replace them with the two terms consisting of the union of the variables, which means x, y, and z, and the term of the intersection of the variables, which is just y. And then we apply some modularity again to these two terms, and we get x, y, z, and the empty set, and h of the empty set is zero. So this is a short proof that the inequality that we have seen here is a Shannon inequality. Good. So in essence, what Pippinger asked in 1986, whether the Shannon inequalities are complete for all information inequalities, is at its essence a question about decidability. If Shannon's inequalities were complete, then it means that we can check every information inequality by checking if it is a consequence of the Shannon inequalities. However, Zhang and Yong, in a surprising result in 1998, they proved the first, they give the first example of an inequality that is valid, but it is not a Shannon inequality. We call it a non-Shannon inequality. Moreover, in 2007, Matouche proved an even more surprising result that there are infinitely many non-Shannon inequalities that are inequivalent. And this only requires four random variables, n equals four. And this ruined any hope for obtaining decidability by listing a finite set of inequalities that are complete for checking all linear inequalities in information theory. So even more interestingly, today we are facing applications that require more complex constraints over information inequalities than the simple linear inequalities. And this is my topic next. I'm going to define the more general decision problems in information theory. So the most general form of decision problem that we're going to consider are Boolean information constraints. A Boolean information constraint is given by a Boolean formula F. Here is a brief example to give you some intuition. This is a Boolean formula with four Boolean variables. And as many vectors of real coefficients, and the Boolean information constraint is just the assertion that this Boolean function applied to the inequalities defined by these vectors of coefficients is true. It is this assertion written here. In this case, we distinguish between validity over entropic vectors and validity over almost entropic vectors. And there are cases where it is known that these two notions of validity differ. So the most general problem that we consider is that of Boolean information constraints, which says, given such a Boolean information constraint, where all the coefficients are integers, check if it is valid for all entropic vectors, or check if it is valid for all almost entropic vectors. Here are a few types of Boolean information constraints that each of them has important applications. The simplest type is that of linear information inequalities or simplest information inequalities like the one we have seen before. And next, we consider max information inequalities. These are of the form the maximum of some expressions greater than or equal to zero, or the maximum of some expressions greater than or equal to some other expression. And these are equivalent to the disjunction, to the Boolean disjunction of several inequalities, hence they are a special case of a Boolean information constraint. More generally, we can consider conditional inequalities. They assert that if some inequalities hold, these preconditions hold, then another inequality holds as well. And finally, we consider general Boolean information constraints, which can have multiple preconditions, and then max inequalities as postconditions. All these types of Boolean information constraints have important applications. And my goal next is to briefly describe these applications before we discuss the complexity of these types of Boolean information constraints. Okay, so one slide about applications. And this only lists four applications, and I invite you to look up the paper for more. The first I want to mention is a beautiful result by Chan from 2007, and he proved that information inequalities are computationally equivalent via one-to-one reductions to certain group theoretic inequalities. And this connection is very direct, it's very one-to-one, and it is a beautiful correspondence between information inequalities and inequalities in group theory. What we proved very recently is that max information inequalities are computationally equivalent via many one reductions to a problem that has been studied intensively in database theory, namely the containment problem for conjunctive queries under Bach semantics. And finally, I want to briefly mention that these Boolean information constraints have applications to secret sharing and to query evaluation over relational databases, and I invite you to check the paper. So clearly, Boolean information constraints have a wide range of applications. So what do we know about their complexity? This is going to be the topic of the next part of this talk. So let me describe the results that we have. All we know is that we can place some types of Boolean information constraints in the arithmetic hierarchy. This one slide is a brief review of the arithmetic hierarchy, also known as a Kleene-Rostowski hierarchy. And this consists of families of subsets of tuples of natural numbers defined as follows. At the base of the hierarchy are the families sigma 0 and pi 0, which consist of all the decidable sets. So every set in sigma 0 or equivalent to pi 0 means a decidable set. Sigma n and pi n are defined using n quantifier alternations. Sigma starts with the existential quantifier and pi starts with the universal quantifier, followed by a decidable set B. So this is a standard arithmetic hierarchy. It is known to be strict, and each set except the base ones contains many undecidable sets, undecidable problems. Good. So with this definition in mind, let me describe the first of three results that I want to mention. And the first result is actually a folklore theorem that I view as a warm-up. And it concerns the simplest information inequalities, which are linear information inequalities. To give you a sense of why they are hard, Here is an example of a non-Shannon inequality taken by Young on information theory. Recall that each conditional mutual information, like this term here, is simply a linear expression of four entropic terms. So this is just a linear inequality over entropic terms that we assert is greater than or equal to zero. It is valid, and it is not a consequence of Shannon inequalities. We do not know how to prove such inequalities in general, except to use ingenuity, which is specialized to each such inequality. However, it is relatively easy to refute them by simply enumerating over all finite probability spaces with rational coefficients. And this brings us to the first theorem. Checking the validity of such an information inequality is in pi 1, and the first level of the arithmetic hierarchy. So a quick proof, we enumerate over all finite probability spaces with rational coefficients. If any of them invalidates the inequality, then we return false. Otherwise, we continue up to infinity with the next probability space. Now, the key piece of the argument that enables us this simple theorem is the following observation. If there exists a finite probability space on which this inequality fails, in which we have the strict inequality in the opposite direction, even if that finite probability space has irrational coefficients, there exists an entire neighborhood of those probability values, of those irrational probability values, such that in that entire neighborhood, any choice of the probability values will still be a refutation of this inequality. And this means that we can also find a probability space with rational probabilities. And this is something that we enumerate in this process over here. However, the simple argument fails in the second case when we consider conditional information inequalities. Here is an example of a conditional information inequality taken from a paper by Kachetov and Romaschenko. It asserts that if these four conditional mutual informations are equal to zero, then this fifth conditional mutual information is equal to zero as well. Now, in our formulas, we discussed inequalities as opposed to equalities, but it is easy to convert each of these assertions into an inequality because it is known that the mutual information is greater than or equal to zero, and therefore equality to zero is equivalent to minus mutual information greater than or equal to zero. For such inequalities, the previous argument no longer holds. If we have a finite probability space whose probabilities might be irrational that forms a violation of this implication, that probability space will have to make all these mutual informations exactly equal to zero. And in general, it is no longer the case that this continues to hold in an entire neighborhood of those probability values. Nevertheless, we can prove that with an additional condition on the preconditions of this of such a conditional inequality, the problem is in pi 3, the third level of the arithmetic hierarchy. And more than the result itself, the proof technique is actually even more interesting, and this is what I'm going to show you next. The proof technique is a method that converts conditional information inequalities into simple linear inequalities. And let me describe you how it goes. Consider the conditional information inequality in equation one. It asserts that if these linear inequalities hold, then so does the consequent. And consider condition two, which is obtained by asserting that the consequent is greater than some positive linear combination of the antecedents. Here, the lambdas are any positive coefficients. Now, it is easy to check that if condition two holds, if this linear inequality holds, then the conditional inequality holds as well, simply because if these preconditions are greater than or equal to zero, then by a condition two, C times H is also greater than or equal to zero. In a surprising result, however, Kachena-Romaschenko proved that the converse fails. It actually fails even on the example that I showed you on the previous slide, which is from their paper. What we proved, however, is that the converse does hold if we allow an error term on the left-hand side of this inequality. More precisely, we considered this condition, which is an alternation of three quantifiers. It says for any epsilon greater than zero, there exist positive coefficients, such that for any almost entropic term, the inequality 2 plus a small error term, which is multiplied just with epsilon, is greater than this linear combination. It is easy to see that 3 continues to imply 1, and what we proved is that the converse also holds. If the conditional inequality holds, then this inequality with an error term holds as well. So, for this result, it is critical that here we take the set of almost entropic terms. This needs to be a closed convex cone, which is the case for the set of almost almost entropic vectors. And it does not apply, we don't know if it holds, for the set of entropic vectors. Now, if in addition all the preconditions are tight, which means that the inequality in the opposite direction is a valid one, then we can further increase the lambdas here because these terms are always less than or equal to zero. So we can increase them to obtain natural numbers, and this places this problem in Bayes' free because it's an alternation of for all exist and for all. Okay, the third problem I want to discuss is that of conditional independence statements between random variables. So this doesn't need the language of entropy. It is simply as these are these concern simply statements of the form. Two random variables y and z are conditionally independent given the values of a random variable x. Such assertions can be written down as equalities over marginal probabilities, as I wrote here. We need to write down such an equality for every outcomes, for every possible outcomes x, y, z of these three random variables, capital X, capital Y, and capital Z. The conditional implication problem has been studied intensively in the literature. It also asks us to check if given some conditional independence between some sets of random variables, another conditional independence holds as well. Now, a conditional independence holds if and only if the mutual information is equal to zero. So therefore, the conditional implication problem is really a special case of a conditional inequality. However, there are two differences from from our previous discussion. First of all, here we are really interested in validity over entropic terms, not over all entropic terms, almost entropic terms. And moreover, here the condition, both the precondition and the consequent, can be written using only multiplication and addition. Addition is needed to write marginal probabilities like P of X. Hence, there is no need for the logarithm. Using this and the fact that the theory of reals with addition and multiplication is decidable, this is a new result by Tarski, we could prove that the conditional implication problem is in pi 1, in the first level of the arithmetic hierarchy. Okay, so this is all the time we have, so let me briefly mention a few words in conclusion. Here is a brief summary of our results. As we can see, there are many boxes that are still open. And I want to mention three points in conclusion. First of all, the question of decidability is related to another question about the set of almost entropic terms, whether this set is semi-algebraic closed. So please see the paper for more discussion. Another interesting question is whether the max information inequalities are computationally equivalent to linear inequalities. Again, we have some evidence in the paper that they might be computationally equivalent. And finally, we want to mention that our result based on Tarski's theorem, in order to extend this to conditional inequalities, one needs to know whether the theory of Fourier's with addition, multiplication, and exponentiation is decidable. And this is a major open problem in model theory today.